Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. We're going to talk about eating almonds and dark chocolate and why it's good and how to prevent psoriasis with a simple kitchen aid. We're also going to discuss, and these are all from mainstream research, how breathing calms your brain and other scientific-based benefits of controlled breathing. And we're going to then look at how mental illness may be passed to offspring from Uppsala University in Sweden and Helsinki University, and a lot more on health and healing. And then we're going to hear an interesting audio clip. I had a person who asked a question about their health, and then after I answered it, they said, by the way, I heard you mention that there's some good millennials, you have some working for you, but also as a whole, the majority are not really up to par. And this is a person that doesn't employ anyone. And this person said, could you give us an example that we could relate to? Yeah, today I'll give you an example. I'll give you an example of a millennial job interview. And all of us in this audience who are self-employed, small business people, boy, will this ring true. And then today, we're going to have an audio clip on consumerism and public health. I've been trying to get to it for several days, but unfortunately, the flow of the program sometimes spends too long in one area. So we're going to get to this day because this is at the heart of so much of our problem in our personal lives. What we buy, do we need it? Is there a better way? Can we go to minimalism? Or have we been so long conditioned to believe that more is better, bigger is better? And what does that cost us? How do we get there? Then I'll ask you for your input. So we're going to have a talkback segment on both the millennial and that segment. No guests today, just so we have time to take your calls. We were flooded yesterday, but unfortunately it didn't. There was like a delay, like suddenly everyone decided after about 5 minutes they wanted to call in. So today when I take a break and ask for your calls, if you intend to call, call immediately so that we get as many on the air as possible. So that's what we're going to be doing. Now let's start. We always start with the latest on ways that we can live a longer and healthier life, and indeed we can. This is from China Medical University. It was published in the Journal of Agricultural and Food Chemistry. It talked about small amounts of vanilla extract. It's also called vanillin, V-A-N-I-L-L-I-N. And it has a wide usage. It's in a lot of different products, mainly baked goods, but it's also in scents and essential oils and perfumes. Well, in this study, they found that the compound could help prevent and reduce psoriasis skin inflammation. I'm sure many of you already know that psoriasis is an inflammatory skin disorder, and it affects over 125 million people worldwide. You get that scaly red plaques that typically show up on your elbows and knees and scalp. And what people don't realize and how I've helped people overcome it is with immune system buildup, because the immune system proteins called interleukin 1, 17, 23, they're known to be key players in the development of the condition. And interestingly, vanilla extract can have effects on different interleukins that are involved in other inflammatory conditions. And so they didn't have to have a lot of this. Just what would be in an eyedropper full made all the difference in the world. So just add that to natural home remedies, natural non-toxic that could help you with skin conditions. You don't put it on the external, you take it internally. Eating almonds and dark chocolate lowers bad cholesterol. This is from Penn State University, published in the Journal of the American Heart Association. Wasn't that kind of interesting? Sad, but interesting that I believe 62 years old, the president of the American Heart Association, when giving a lecture this week, had a heart attack. Well, okay, the question is, if you looked at his lifestyle and his behavior and his diet, is that in accordance with the American Heart Association? Now, the American Heart Association has in the past given information that would be mixed, and I would challenge a lot of it, and some of it I would certainly support. But then you have to look at where does it get its income, its revenue stream, and how might that impact it? And indeed, there were companies at one time that were able to promote using the logo, you know, recommended or American Heart Association approved, and in other words, some way monikering their brand using the American Heart Association. And that's where a lot of us really took issue, that when you have someone paying your bills, what is the probability that you can be 100% objective? Not saying it's not possible. It is possible, but highly improbable, especially in that market where every year they have a bigger and bigger budget. If the American Heart Association promoted 100% organic, healthy, plant-based diet and the use of supplements that there are thousands, tens of thousands of studies in the scientific literature supporting cleaning our arteries, like pomegranate and vitamin E, the mixed tocopherols, and coenzyme Q10 and L-carnitine and magnesium, we would reduce the incidence of heart disease by at least 60 to 70%. That's saving an awful lot of lives. If with a simple, inexpensive, natural method, you could save 500,000 people, 500,000 people in America alone each year, why not? And where common sense and reason dictate, yeah, why not? Then you get into the, well, we also get donations from this and that and the other, and they do not have heart-friendly products. In fact, if you look at some of the people that donate and put their money widely spread around different industries and universities, a lot of it promotes disease, including for the heart. So here's good information. You want to have a healthier heart. You want to have lower bad cholesterol, meaning the LDL cholesterol? Chocolate and almonds. Eating nearly a third a cup of almonds a day, either alone or combined with almost one quarter cup of dark chocolate, that's 2 1/3 tablespoons of cacao. And it's easy to do. You can just put all that into a blender. You can put your almond butter. That would be 1 tablespoon of almond butter, or that would be 2 1/4 tablespoons of cacao in your mix. Now you can pour that into an oatmeal, into a quinoa, into millet, and have a wonderful, tasty breakfast. That's especially good for diabetics because it stabilizes the blood sugar. It doesn't allow those sharp spikes. And if you did that, that can reduce your risk of coronary heart disease. And that was published in the Journal of the American Heart Association, and it found that combining raw almonds and dark chocolate and cacao significantly reduced the number of low-density lipoproteins. And just so you know, the LDLs, those are the particles in your blood if you're overweight or obese, and it's often called the bad cholesterol because the role it plays in clogging arteries. So you want to make sure that you're having a good cholesterol and good LDL, which is a low LDL, and a good HDL, which is a high. Remember, HDL high, LDL low. So that's good. Now, we all know that, well, I'm sure most people in this audience around the world, at some point when you were growing up, a parent or a grandparent, an aunt or an uncle, when you got angry, they said, just calm down, take some deep breaths. Right? Or maybe they said, just get away from here, breathe deeply, and count to 10. Remember that? They were right. According to this new report that was just published in Forbes magazine, they're finally understanding that there is a science of breathing that is centuries old, And that innate wisdom instructs us to pay closer attention to our breathing. That's one of the most basic things we do each day. And yet, maybe because breathing is so basic, we simply ignore it. So here's what we now know, and this will help everyone. While the admonition to control breathing to calm the brain has been around for ages, now we're looking at a new study that says that when you're breathing slow and calm, you're impacting your neural circuit in the brainstem that plays a role in the breathing-brain control connection. The circuit, according to Forbes, is part of what's been called the brain's breathing pacemaker. Why? Because it can be adjusted by altering breathing rhythm, meaning slow, controlled breathing decreases the activity in the circuit, where fast, erratic breathing increases activity, which in turn influences emotional states. How many times have you been mad yourself or someone else, and suddenly they can't breathe, and it's all up here in their throat, and you say, just calm down. Calm down. Now, deep, relaxing breathing. And it makes an enormous difference. And you should do that for about 5 minutes. What else does it do? It regulates your blood pressure. Those who have shallow, fast breathing, more tending towards high blood pressure, those who have slow, rhythmic breathing, slower breathing. You actually, the scientific study shows that using controlled breathing to lower blood pressure and heart rate can lower the risk of stroke and cerebral aneurysms and generally decreases the stress on your blood vessels. And that's a big plus when it comes to cardiovascular health. And also, when you count your breath, that directly aligns with your brain's emotional control regions. That's a separate study. A quote, neuronal oscillations throughout the brain, particularly the brain region related to emotion, is controlled by breathing. That means that when you are breathing erratically, you're not going to have the same calming mental capacity as if you're relaxed in your breathing. So you can impact and boost your immune system. You can improve your energy metabolism by breathing deeply. And it was a term called relaxation response. I'm sure many people in the audience remember that 1970s book by Dr. Herbert Benson, who was a co-author of a study which referred to a method of engaging in parasympathetic nervous system control by simply reducing your flight and fight mechanism and stress by controlling your breathing, which then controls your parasympathetic response. Give you a little example of this. I once went out into a race. It was just a 4-mile race around Center Park, and I was highly trained for it. But I made the mistake of, after about the first quarter mile, being one of the top 4 or 5 athletes. This is when I was a runner. And I suddenly realized that I had not been breathing. And so I tried to get my deep breath in at that time, but it was too late. By the first mile mark, there was not enough oxygen in my system, what is called oxygen debt. So your muscles are requiring more oxygen than what you're breathing in, and the blood, the red blood cells, carry the oxygen molecule to the cells where it releases it, and you're able to create what is called ATP, adenosine triphosphate, which is the actual combustion of energy in the cell so the cell can actually function. In its absence, in the absence of enough oxygen, because you're not breathing deeply, you end up with lactic acid buildup. And those lactic acid crystals are what cause the pain, the burn. And then you slow down. So by the end of the next mile, I was like 200, 300 people ahead of me because I went out too fast. And my breathing was off. I learned a lesson. And from then on, every race I did, I went out almost dead last. But I was relaxed, and I got my stride. And I got my body into the race gradually, but my breathing was deep, deep diaphragmatic breathing. And I was focused on my breathing because a lot of athletes may not appreciate this, but when it comes to long-distance sports, breathing is half the effort. In fact, I'll watch athletes that I'm on a track or on a course, out and back course, I'll watch how deep they're breathing. You can tell. And when their arms start to come up and their head starts to go down a little bit and they're rocking on their heels, they're in oxygen debt. So we thought it was all just the muscles. No, it's not. It's the breathing. So just try relaxing and breathing. Deep, not shallow. From the National Institute of Health and Uppsala University in Sweden and Helsinki University, they're calling it mental illness. I'm not. I call it emotional imbalance. But it's associated with early childhood adversity, and it can actually be passed from generation to generation. That's according to a study of adults whose parents evacuated Finland as children during World War II. And the study was conducted by researchers at the National Institutes of Health, and it was published in the Journal of the American Medical Association Psychiatry. And the research team found that daughters of female evacuees had the same high risk of mental health disorders as their mothers, even though they did not experience the same adversity. The study could not determine why the higher risk of mental illness persisted across generations. I believe that I have that answer because there's a whole field, it's an amazing field called epigenetics, EPA, E-P-I, genetic, G-E-N-E-T-I-C. These epigenetic changes, they're literally, figuratively, chemical alterations in the gene expression without any changes to the underlying DNA. So you won't be able to look at a DNA and tell, but the vibration and the energy inside, the message inside the DNA, is what they cannot yet measure. Quote, many studies have shown that traumatic exposure during pregnancy can have negative effects on offspring. And then it goes on to talk about how this one was far worse than that. So here is the takeaway message from this, that we've got to understand that everything that happens to us in our life leaves a message. And that message can then impact ourselves. And so let's say we're young, we are experiencing something that we don't like, and we don't know how to intellectualize it, so we express it internally. Our gene never forgets anything. It's coded in there. Now, every time you think on something, let's say you've had a problem, and it wasn't resolved to your satisfaction. You broke up with someone, you lost a job, and the reasons they gave you for firing you weren't legitimate in your mind. So you keep having that argument over and over and over again. Do you realize that every time you think on something, you recreate that in the neuron vault? Your DNA literally are bringing it in as if it happened 20 years ago, but now you're thinking of it, so it's re-happening today. And we do not have anything in our society representing a transition of pain, a transition of sorrow, a transition of loss, a transition of trauma. We have nothing. We're just told, get over it. Well, easy to say, get over it. It's not so easy. You have to go through a process to understand what impact that early experience has had on your life, and then how do you not engage it? It's always there. Remember it. This whole thing that we can expunge memories, we can get them out of us, that's all nonsense. That's hokum. Every single thing that's ever happened to you in your life, everything that's ever said to you, every emotion you've ever felt in your life, it's there for the rest of your life. The key is, the art is not to engage it. Don't allow it back in. Those are all subconscious energies trying to compete and get back into our conscious mind. By staying mindfully conscious, you then look at the solutions you have present in this moment to deal with whatever it is you're faced with. And one of the most important lessons is, don't personalize everything. And yet, we fall right. right into that epigenetic trap of someone says something we don't like, and suddenly a whole door opens up and a million different responses from things that we didn't like that people said in the past come out. So we have no control over ourselves. We go into rage, we go into crying, we go into blaming, we go into a hostile confrontation, but we're not dealing with anything. It's nothing's going to change. But when you stay mindful, someone says something you don't like, say, okay, you've expressed yourself. I appreciate that. I can share a difference of opinion. That's not what happened. That's not my perception. I believe you've taken something I said or did out of context. Now let me share my impression of that moment and see if you can appreciate my perspective of it. Now you're staying conscious, so you're not going to trigger your flight or fight response. You're not going to overstress yourself. Your blood pressure is not going to skyrocket. Cortisol is not going to go through the roof. Your heart rate's not going to race. Your digestion's not going to be upset. You're not going to start sweating. You're just going to stay calm and deal with it. It's just information. If all we did was look at things as information, I remember walking around my property the day after the hurricane, my ranch that I live on, and there's this wonderful caretaking couple, and they were just devastated. And I said, hey, I said, show me all the good reasons that we should be happier today than we were yesterday. There's nothing to be happy about. Yeah, there is. Yeah. See where all those shrubs are over? Look at all the sunlight pouring through. You didn't see that sunlight before. And did you ever go in there? It was too dense. Bougainvillea overcrowding an area. Now, clear it out and make a beautiful rose garden. Well, look at that hut. The hut's warped. Good. It'll be torn down. And now where the hut was, we'll build another flower garden. Already has a concrete floor. So that way you can have a formal, beautiful garden you can go out and sit in. Did you ever go in that hut? No. Well, now you will. So I was trying to show them it's just information. Don't personalize it. Look at something in the moment consciously, mindfully, that you can do to change a problem into a solution. And that's how we get through life. Other cultures seem to be a little better adapted dealing with this than we are. And that's unfortunate because people don't need to suffer. But just remember, if your mom or grandmom went through, or dad went through crisis in their lives, there's a high probability that epigenetic influence has altered your genes. Now the key is, and that's especially true of Holocaust survivors, they have higher levels of compounds known as methyl groups bound to the gene FKBBP5. And that have passed this change on to their children. And what it means is this higher level of methyl groups appears to alter the production of cortisol, a hormone that regulates the stress hormone. So what that means in lay language is that if your parents went through the Holocaust, you as a child that did not go through the Holocaust, you're going to have a higher reactivity to cortisol. You're going to be reacting to things that otherwise you may not react to. And finally, McMaster's University, which is up in Ontario, a good university, they found that antibiotic administration during labor affects the development of gut bacteria in babies. And so the research showed that babies exposed to the antibiotics during labor had a delay in the maturation of their gut bacteria. And you know what that is called. It's called microbiota, B-I-O-T-A. That means that you're going to have healthier bacteria from a breastfed child, infant, unless the mother had antibiotics, in which case then the antibiotics will adversely affect her own gut bacteria, and then she's passing on the antibody response to that. So try not to have antibiotics when you're pregnant. Tomorrow, from a Korean university in Seoul, smartphone addiction creates imbalance in your brain. But right now we're going to take a break. We're 25 minutes into our program. I'm Gary Null. Back in a moment. Please stay with us. I'd like to welcome all of you, and we're going to be taking your calls in a little bit, but this is a short piece. It's only 2.5 minutes long. It's a millennial job interview, and I've had these, and I'm sure some of you have had them, but for those of you who have not, here's what you could reasonably expect.
It says you are trained in technology. That's very good. Are you adept at Excel?
No.
PowerPoint?
No.
Publisher?
Not really.
Exactly in what area of technology are you proficient?
Snapchat, Pinterest, Instagram, Vine, Twitter. You know the big ones.
I'm surprised you didn't say Facebook.
That's for old people, like my parents. That's funny.
Well, Amy, when you're working for me, you have to have those kind of research skills because I'll send you things for you to comb through and get the answers and send them to me. So for that, you've got to be really good at technology.
For stuff like that, no problem. I'll just ask Siri.
You'll just ask Siri?
You know, Siri tell me this, Siri find me that. We're all good getting you the answers.
Tell Siri I want you ready to go at 8 sharp each and every morning.
I don't understand.
What don't you understand?
What you just said.
You don't understand be ready to go?
No. You said 8, right?
Yes.
8, like, in the morning, 8?
Yes, in the morning.
Yeah. That kind of doesn't work for me. Who gets up at 8?
I do.
I Skype with my French boyfriend in Paris until like 3 in the morning. I don't even get to Starbucks until like 10, where I order my grande chai tea latte, 3 pumps, skim milk, light water, 2% foam, extra hot, but not too hot. So if it's okay, I work best in the morning at 10:45.
Wow. Amy, I don't think we're going to be a good fit.
Why are you so negative? I can sense your hostilities, and right now I am not feeling very safe. I've been here for over 5 minutes, and the only nice thing you have said to me was nice resume, which I typed all night for this meeting with you. You've given me no guidance, no validation, no encouragement, no supervision. Is there an HR director somewhere?
HR director?
Yes, I need to speak to someone. I may have to take off today as a mental health day.
Take today off? Amy, look at me. You don't work here.
Are you firing me?
Okay, yes.
That is a realistic conversation. I've had many of them. But the good news is that I can also show you some really wonderful young people. And more often than not, you have to give a lot of credit to their parents and other people that gave them some boundaries and held them responsible for their own individual thoughts and actions. Do you believe that we are encouraging the majority of our young people to flounder in this vortex of uncertainty? Student debt is higher than ever. They can go about $30,000 a year for each year they're in college with compounding interest. There's no way they're going to pay that off. The jobs are not there. Why aren't we discouraging some people from going to college and instead look at other opportunities for them to learn skills that are more likely to give them a living wage today and postpone or delay, unless they are going into a specific field like the health field, that is requiring education and licensing, and there are plenty of jobs now, and there will be in the future. But look at all the people who are now going to be unemployed on factory floors because of automation. And also look at those people who have worked themselves up to a position of security and good financial income at 20 years, 25 years, 30 years, and seniority, and now they're being wiped out. Over 100,000 a year from people coming in from foreign countries who are willing to work for one half to one third that with none of the benefits or bonuses. And that's going to be more and more. And look at artificial intelligence and all the jobs it's replacing. So when we look honestly and realistically at what a young person has to go through, we're not preparing them. That's our responsibility. And if they're not fully prepared, then what are we going to say to them when we've co-signed as the guarantor of their student loan, and now they're at home without a job they like or don't want to be getting up too early in the morning, they'll get up at noon, and yet we're the ones that could lose our home or have our wages attached. And by the way, they're senior citizens having their Social Security garnished also part of it. They can't take all of, by the way, they can take every single penny you have in your bank account. Loan companies can, and default. And a lot of those loans, their companies that buy debt, they'll pay 10 cents on the dollar, 5 cents on the dollar, and then they go out and they hound you. Those are the people that can have you arrested if you live in a town or a state that still allows debtors' prisons, which should be unconstitutional since they were banned in the 1820s. But no one's taken it to court to close these operations down. So that's what's going on. Now look at look at the values of a millennial. Look at the values of a senior generation and a millennial generation and an X generation and a Y generation. There are different values, different ways of communicating, different senses of motivation. And now you see what we're really dealing with, and we have not come to grips with this as a society. Why not? What aren't we doing? What are parents not doing? Again, please allow that I'm guessing, and this is merely a guesstimate, which is subjective, that I'm guesstimating upon only my experience. I cannot refer to anyone else, that about 10% of millennials have got their act together, are aware of the world, want to participate in it, want to start a third party politically, don't want to be a part of the Democrats or Republicans, are connected to the environment, are going on plant-based diets, are very environmentally conscious. They're very together people. Much like my generation in the 1960s and 70s, very together. So what is the answer? That will be one of our talkback questions I'm going to ask you. And our talkback number is 888-874-4888. I'm going to take some of those calls now because this next one's on consumerism. And you're going to hear that. That's a longer piece. And then I'll take questions on consumerism, which if you just stop for a moment and ask, how many of the things in our life do we need? Do we really need? And then what did it cost us to possess those things? And what would happen if we just didn't need all this stuff? Which is one of the reasons I am a big supporter of intentional communities. But you got to have the right people in an intentional community for it to work. I see all across the world there are intentional communities and they're really thriving, unless you get the wrong kind of people. If you get the adaptive, aggressive lifestyles who are going to manipulate anyone and everything and they can for their own needs, who bring their dramas and problems and crisis, then you're going to have problems. And they're not going to work, and they'll ultimately implode. Or if you get cult leaders that it's all about them and wanting to give you a new religious or, you know, life belief system, that doesn't work either. I'm talking about intelligent, evolved human beings coming from moral principles to have their own sense of autonomy, do their own projects and things, but share some things in common with other people so that there is a sense of the community, much like a good neighborhood. So I see that happening too, and a lot of millennials are supportive of that, as are a lot of older people who've been through most of their life situations up to this point, learned some lessons, now want something different and are not afraid to say goodbye to those chapters of their life that should have been closed a long time ago. There's nothing more frustrating than to wake up one day and realize, my God, why have I been in the same place for so long? Why didn't I get out of it? Why didn't I go forward? Why didn't I offer myself new challenges? So we'll deal with that in a moment. So our number is 888-874-4888. It's the question about the millennials, not to condemn them, but rather to offer some suggestions that would help people intending to be parents today or people who are in high school today who have not had necessarily the type of parenting that would provide them with a realistic understanding of the real world that they're about to enter. Sooner or later, a person has to get out of their home, their basement, upstairs, and coexist in the real world and bring something hopefully constructive, creative, and that makes it a better world for all of us. And so let us see what your solutions are. I'm going to take a brief break and come back. Hopefully we'll have some questions or answers for these questions. Back in a moment. Nice to have you with us, everyone. By the way, the person who runs Progressive Radio Network in New York, Jesse, said, last night we had a ton of people who came to download Tuesday night's Progressive Commentary Hour, a special 2.5-hour presentation, an honest, accurate historical chronology of the Clintons from before they went to Arkansas in political office to right up till today. It's the most comprehensive you're ever going to know, so at least you know the truth, no matter what the Spinmeisters say about all the foibles. But remember, you're up against a very powerful dynastic family, and these are not people that play right. Let's see, right now at this second, I do not see calls, so we're going to go over to our consumerism and public relations history. And hopefully we'll have some at the end of this. Please listen in.
When Whippoorwill calls. This episode is about Freud's American nephew, Edward Bernays. Bernays is almost completely unknown today, but his influence on the 20th century was nearly as great as his uncle's. Because Bernays was the first person to take Freud's ideas about human beings and use them to manipulate the masses. He showed American corporations for the first time how they could make people want things they didn't need by linking mass-produced goods to their unconscious desires. Out of this would come a new political idea of how to control the masses. By satisfying people's inner selfish desires, one made them happy and thus docile. It was the start of the all-consuming self, which has come to dominate our world today. Bernays set out to experiment with the minds of the popular classes. His most dramatic experiment was to persuade women to smoke. At that time, there was a taboo against women smoking, and one of his early clients, George Hill, the president of the American Tobacco Corporation, asked Bernays to find a way of breaking it.
He said, we're losing half of our market because men have invoked a taboo against women smoking in public. Can you do anything about that? I said, let me think about it. And then I said, have I your permission to see a psychoanalyst to find out what cigarettes mean to women? He said, what'll it cost? So I called up Dr. Brill, A.A. Brill, who was a leading psychoanalyst in New York at that time.
How come you didn't call your uncle? Why didn't you call your uncle?
Because he was in Vienna.
A.A. Brill was one of the first psychoanalysts in America. And for a large fee, he told Bernays that cigarettes were a symbol of the penis and of male sexual power. He told Bernays that if he could find a way to connect cigarettes with the idea of challenging male power, then women would smoke, because then they would have their own penises. Every year, New York held an Easter Day parade to which thousands came. And Bernays decided to stage an event there. He persuaded a group of rich debutantes to hide cigarettes under their clothes. Then they should join the parade, and at a given signal from him, they were to light up the cigarettes dramatically. Bernays then informed the press that he had heard that a group of suffragettes were preparing to protest by lighting up what they called torches of freedom.
He knew this would be an outcry, and he knew that all of the photographers would be there to capture this moment. And so he was ready with a phrase, which was torches of freedom. And so here you have a symbol, women, young women, debutantes, smoking a cigarette in public with a phrase that means anybody who believes in this kind of equality pretty much has to support them in the ensuing debate about this, because torches of freedom. I mean, what's on all American coins? It's liberty. She's holding up the torch, you see? And so all of this is there together. There's emotion, there's memory, there's a rational phrase, even though it's using a lot of emotional elements, it's a phrase that works in a rational sense. All of this is together. And so the next day, this was not just in all of the New York papers, it was across the United States and around the world. And from that point forward, the sale of cigarettes to women began to rise. He had made them socially acceptable with a single symbolic act.
What Bernays had created was the idea that if a woman smoked, it made her more powerful and independent. An idea that still persists today.
Embrace me, my sweet embrace.
It made him realize that it was possible to persuade people to behave irrationally if you link products to their emotional desires and feelings. The idea that smoking actually made women freer was completely irrational, but it made them feel more independent. It meant that irrelevant objects could become powerful emotional symbols of how you wanted to be seen by others.
Eddie Bernays saw the way to sell product was not to sell it to your intellect, that you ought to buy an automobile, but that you will feel better about it if you have this automobile. I think he originated that idea, that they weren't just purchasing something, but they were engaging themselves emotionally or personally in the product or service. That it's not, you think you need a new piece of clothing, but you'll feel better with the piece of clothing. That was his contribution in a very real sense. We see it all over the place today, but I think he originated the idea of the emotional connect to a product or service.
Bernays really is the guy within the United States more than anybody else who sort of brings to the table psychological theory as something that is an essential part of how we are going to appeal to the masses effectively, and the whole sort of merchandising establishment and sales establishment is ready for Sigmund Freud. I mean, they are ready for understanding what motivates the human mind. And so that there's this real openness to Bernays' techniques being used to sell products to the masses.
Beginning in the early 20s, the New York banks funded the creation of chains of department stores across America. They were to be the outlets for the mass-produced goods, and Bernays' job was to produce the new type of customer. Bernays began to create many of the techniques of mass consumer persuasion that we now live with. He was employed by William Randolph Hearst to promote his new women's magazines, and Bernays glamorized them by placing articles and advertisements that linked products made by others of his clients to famous film stars like Clara Bow, who was also his client. Bernays also began the practice of product placement in the movies, and he dressed the stars at the film's premieres with clothes and jewelry from other firms he represented. He was, he claimed, the first person to tell car companies they could sell cars as symbols of male sexuality. He employed psychologists to issue reports that said products were good for you and then pretended they were independent studies. He organized fashion shows in the department stores and paid celebrities to repeat the new and essential message. You bought things not just for need, but to express your inner sense of yourself to others.
I don't think he felt that all those publics out there would had reliable judgment, and that they very easily might vote for the wrong man or want the wrong thing, so that they had to be guided from above. Enlightened despotism, in a sense. You appeal to their desires and their unrecognized longings, that sort of thing. That you can tap into their deepest desires or their deepest fears and use that to your own purposes.
And then, in 1928, a president came to power who agreed with Bernays. President Hoover was the first politician to articulate the idea that consumerism had become the central motor of American life. After his election, he told a group of advertisers and public relations men, "You have taken over the job of creating desire and have transformed people into constantly moving happiness machines. Machines which have become the key to economic progress." What was beginning to emerge in the 1920s was a new idea of how to run mass democracy. At its heart was the consuming self, which not only made the economy work, but was happy and docile, and so created a stable society.
That's part one. I'll continue with part two tomorrow. I did have calls up, I just didn't see them on my computer screen here. So let's go over and say hello to Mike from New Jersey. Hi, Mike, your turn. Mike, you're on the air. All right, let's say hello to David. David, you're on.
Yes, thank you very much, Gary. What I remember is that I'm the David that you read my book, Playing the Game, and you called me and complimented me on it. I heard you talk some time ago about starting up the a new healing center. And you also mentioned that you perhaps were going to be connected with 501c3. So I think it would be a wonderful thing if that could happen, and I would certainly like to contribute to that and maybe help get a grant to get a healing center going again. So that's what I remember you talking about on one program some time ago.
Okay. Well, that's not on the topic I'm asking about, but I will address it. Back in the early 1980s through almost 2000, I had the Tri-State Healing Center, and thousands upon thousands of people came there, and the purpose was to bring together physicians, board-certified physicians in their specialties, and people in healing modalities, a holistic chiropractic, acupuncturist, colon therapist, Dr. Amara Gadol, holistic dentist, massage therapist, chelation, intravenous ozone. We had every specialization, and we helped people, and that's where I was able to help 1,200 persons with full-blown AIDS and on their road to recovery. And of those individuals, 8 completely reversed their HIV status and their diseases totally. They were 100% made well, and others, their immune system went into a completely healthy state. I could not have done that as an individual, because in any given evening there would have been about, 50 people getting their therapies, and those therapies generally took 4 hours, and with the nurses and everything else they had. So I did that, and now everything's changed. I couldn't even afford the rent on that because I didn't charge people, and that came out of my pocket. Also, it gave me a chance to see how many doctors were doing it for the right reason, how many were just interested in their own careers, making lots of money. And that's why there was a rather strong turnover of physicians there, because not all the doctors were, they called themselves holistic, but they were not humanistic, though they certainly had talents. Today, I don't believe that that kind of center would work. I believe that we have gone on from there. I think that we have to have a completely different approach, and I'm working on that as we speak, but that is going to be competing with other ideas, documentaries, and books for the next 6 to 9 months. And then I'll get back to that topic and share with you ideas what I think will be the next step in having the public not just bring their broken bodies and diseased limbs to a place and have people help them back, but I believe our next step in America should be a more integrated construct of holistic thinking and hence teaching and hence selection and prevention of disease in the future than to try to come in after a person's sick and then to rehabilitate them. So that will be the next step. But the center I had, that won't happen again. It was there. That's a chapter. We had it. But I thank you for your call. I want to stick with the topic. I'm going to stick with the topic, please. Let's say hello to Jerry from Staten Island. Jerry, do you have some insight on millennials for us?
Sure, I do. I have two children now, and they're great kids, great adult kids. But them, like many other friends, like you were mentioning yesterday, it's not showing people what to do. They need why to do it. It's like you heal many people, but what worked was they were on the right path of truth. Not to get too psychobabble and whatnot. The thing is, why do you keep your audience so limited? It's like you do get a lot of downloads. But let's say Staten Island is in some areas of an affluent community. Why don't you take the leap and say, you know what, here's a storefront. This isn't a great area. They're all, and do your demographics and say, these children need to be fed. The church isn't feeding people like they used to in the 15th, 16th, and 17th century for problems and circumstances that occurs in everybody's life. The church has been removed purposely, accidentally, or just the evolution of society. But I still love my kids, and I know you have a daughter. And so I used to say, hey, this life sucks. I'm going to take it easy and just coast, but I'm going to be a grandfather. I want to leave them something more than just material things that you talk about. People need a faith, and that's why I think the opiate crisis, I never did drugs, by the way, because these people, and look at New Jersey, the governor is legalizing marijuana. Is that the first thing a state should do? They have such bad financial crisis, the structure's falling apart, but what is the government doing?
Jerry, slow it down a moment, please. Now, just breathe deeply, all right?
And you got it. I am only trying to get a life experience.
But you've made several different points. Let's examine a few of them to see what we can learn.
And I'm going to get off the phone because
I'm giving you a chance, Jerry, but please, I can't answer if you're going to talk over me, and I don't believe in competing for talking over one another. Could I answer your question and statement?
Yes.
Okay. Start with New Jersey. I would be very happy if every state legalized marijuana and then legalized all drugs and emptied out the prisons and gave a complete pardon and expunged the record of everyone who was there. I believe that every one of those people who used drugs or sold drugs, unless they were violent, that's different, should be given another chance of life. They should be given an opportunity to go back in for public housing, which they're now excluded from, a right to vote, which they're excluded from, and a right to participate in society as if it's a new day. I believe that you take the money that you save, over $50,000 a year per prisoner, and you put it into community action where you have those storefronts you're talking about opening up, but you have them in every one of the communities in New Jersey or any other state where people can go in there and they can get the kind of health counseling, psychological counseling, career counseling, where you take a whole block, and so therefore you would have what type of trade. Do you need a trade? We'll show you a trade. We'll teach you a trade. Do you need education? We'll get you an education in here. Do you need some physical assistance? We'll get you that. Do you need psychological assistance? We'll get you that. If you had that type of public assistance with all the great minds we have as sociologists, psychologists, behavioralists, and therapists, as well as craftspersons, and think of people like yourself who've had a noble life, I'm assuming it is, and think of all the unionists and others who have a trade and mastered it, think if they could donate their time to helping others who are just starting off in life and need a trade. So if you did that in the state of New Jersey, A, you're going to reduce recidivism, you're going to reduce crime, you're going to bring prosperity more to a neighborhood. If you had a community garden that people could learn gardening and then eat the food from which they had grown, that is putting your energy into a local community. I believe that all politics should start with local politics, start there, and then influence it up to the state. I don't believe in a large federal government. I believe in a small federal government that is there strictly to serve the needs of the people by keeping all of our commons, the oceans, the lakes, the rivers, the streams, the estuaries, our parks in pristine condition and not be exploited and not be drilled on and not be sold off. I don't believe in privatization. I also believe that that government should be there to help people instead of what it is now, a giant cancer on the psyche of Americans, where we fear our government, and rightly so, because of what it does domestically and foreign interventions. If you dismantled that, took away that power, closed down all those agencies, closed down those military bases, fired everyone and started over, and then make sure that what they're going to do actually makes the life of a person in America and around the world better. If we, instead of sending bombs and munitions to other countries, we sent wise men and women to heal the wounds and help them rehabilitate their societies, if we finally understood the 80% of all the Muslim nations are Sunni, and the largest promoter of terrorism around the world are the Saudis, and they're the ones opening the schools of madrasas and teaching Wahhabism, the most radical, dehumanizing form of that. But you have to work within the other Shia and other Sunni communities that do not support Wahhabism and nonviolence and respect for life and respect for women and tolerance for other religions. We're not doing any of that. We're doing nothing I just mentioned. Now, if we did that, then you would have an entire army of millennials who would go to your first and important question or issue, and that is that we should ask the young people, what do you believe in and why? And they would want to believe in a world that was being made better for everyone, not just for those who are powerful, the oligarchs, the technocrats, and the functioning bureaucrats to their machinery. I appreciate your call. Thank you very much, Jerry. I'm Gary Null. We're out of time. And by the way, for the 3,000 people that downloaded the archives last night, anyone else want to listen? You can listen by going live just over the Internet, or you can call and download the 2.5-hour special. That number is 424-203-8046, 424-203-8046 for the 2.5-hour special on the Clintons. Look forward to sharing more tomorrow. Have a nice day, everyone.